Hello and welcome to the episode 84 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Among the highlights of the day, we have the Beatles busy filming two flixes, the infamous Butcher photos and A Bed In for Peace. Let's start with the 25th of March 1962 and with a performance at peak bestseller for the Beatles. You've guessed it. We're talking about the Casbah Coffee Club in Liverpool. 1 year later, in 1963, the Beatles spent their one-day break from the Montez Row package tour with a photographer called Dezo Hoffmann. Moving through various locations in London, they managed to shoot a number of black and white photographs and a color 8mm home film. In 1964, the Beatles were again at the Scala Theatre in London for more filming for their Hard Day's Night movie. More shooting in 1965 too, this time at the Twickenham Film Studios in London, with the Fab Four busy with yet another day of filming of the interior temple scenes for Eight Arms to Hold You, better known with its definitive name, Help. And I do need somebody, not just anybody, to help me focusing even more on the creation of top-notch free music-related material for you to enjoy. Are you fab enough to lend a hand? Find out for yourself heading to www.simonmas.com/support at the end of this show. No donation is too small, and you can do a lot for free too. For example, you can tell all of your friends about this podcast. Help me if you can, you can make the difference. Thank you! On the 25th of March 1966, the Beatles were at the Vale Photographic Studio in London. While the main focus of the day was a photo session with photographer Robert Whitaker, the Fabs recorded an interview between 3 and 3:30pm, held by Tom Lodge, DJ of Pirate Radio Radio Caroline. It was to be featured, along with other interviews with other successful acts, on a flexi disc distributed to readers of a new weekly paper, Disc and Music Echo. As this imaginative title might suggest, the paper was the result of the merging between the old and well-established Disc paper and Music Echo, owned by Beatles manager Brian Epstein. The involvement of Epstein and his personal stake in the deal probably eased the contribution by the Beatles. The disc, called Sound of the Stars, was put together by NEMS press officer Tony Barrow. Among others, Cilla Black, Cliff Richard, The Hollies, Pete Townsend, Spencer Davis, The Walker Brothers and Sandy Shaw were featured in the disc. After the interview, and before the session with Whitaker, the Beatles also posed for a photo session with Nigel Dickson for the Beatles Book magazine. This session produced the tartan-neck sweater and jacket look that became the band's standard promotional look of 1966. And then, finally, the Butcher pictures. Whitaker wanted to create pictures that served as a commentary on the Beatles' fame, inspired by German artist Hans Bellmer's dismembered doll and mannequin parts work. Whitaker took pictures of the band with false teeth, broken dolls, and raw meat. He wanted to produce three rough, provocative images, featuring the four Beatles on a golden background with a silver halo. In due course, people maintained that the photos were a commentary about the treatment of the band by the public, the press, and Capitol Records, their American label, which dismembered their albums to reassemble them. Interviewed about the matter by Goldmine magazine in 1991, as reported by BeatlesBible.com, Whitaker commented, "Rubbish, absolute nonsense. If the trilogy or the triptych of the three photographs had ever come together, it would have made sense. There is another set of photos in the book which is the Beatles with a girl with her back toward you, hanging on to sausages. Those sausages were meant to be an umbilical cord. Does this start to open a few chapters? Frankly, it doesn't for me, but perhaps it does to you? Anyhow, the three photographs were never fully completed, and the central piece of the triptych, nicknamed the Butcher Picture, was to become the cover of Capitol Records' album Yesterday and Today in early June 1966. The cover caused an outcry from retailers. The album was recalled and reissued with a new picture on the cover, also taken by Whitaker. Capitol didn't print another cover though, but simply pasted the new photo over the old one. Peeling off the new cover was rather easy, or so I'm told. 1969. John Lennon and Yoko Ono, conscious that their marriage would have attracted the attention of media and fans, decided to use the opportunity to talk about world peace. They opened their bedroom at the Hilton Hotel in Amsterdam to anyone that wanted an interview, turning their honeymoon into a happening, a bed-in that would saturate the media with 18 hours a day of interviews on newspapers, radios, and TV broadcasts. The idea was the result of Yoko's love for unfinished works of art that needed the audience participation to turn into a complete and unique experience, united with John's fame, witty humor, magnetic personality, and ability to deal with the press to get as much attention as possible. Despite the harsh, almost hostile remarks and the scorn that the couple had to endure for their admittedly naive position about world peace, they kept talking about their message for almost a year, with other bed-ins and happenings. They also managed to have this week-long event filmed, later producing a 60-minute edit titled Honeymoon, directed by Peter Goessens. In addition, some audio recordings made during the week were edited into one of the sides of the wedding album, John Lennon's and Yoko Ono's third experimental LP. They might have been naive, but John and Yoko managed to focus the attention of the masses on the problem with their utopian and simple message. On the 25th of March 1970, Phil Spector was at work at the EMI Studios on the Get Back material, mixing Two of Us, For Your Blue, with the new vocal track by George, recorded on the 8th of January, and Teddy Boy. This last song was not included in the Let It Be album, either because it was not featured in the film, or because Paul McCartney was including a newly recorded version of the song on his first solo LP. During the day, Ringo Starr was interviewed by David Wigg for BBC Radio 1's Seen and Heard. The edited interview was aired in two shows, on the 29th of March and on the 5th of April, both times between 3 and 4 pm. Ringo talked about John Lennon. He could jump off the Eiffel Tower and I'd approve it. About whether or not their wives had influence over the Beatles' activities and how much. About his acting career, about his first solo album, Sentimental Journey, and about other random subjects. Ringo also confirmed that the Beatles were as united as ever, saying that there was no talk of splitting the band up. And this, my friends, is the end of another episode of What a Fab Day. I hope you liked it. If you want, drop me a line with your comments about the show or about the stories that I tell you. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation. Simon Mas, music you love.